This is the Thriving Dentist Show with Gary Takas, where we help you develop your ideal dental practice, one that provides personal, professional, and financial satisfaction. Here's your host, Andy Traub.
Hello and welcome to another episode of the Thriving Dentist Show. I'm your host, Andy Traub. The most effective dental marketing is an integrated marketing plan where everything is coordinated to work most effectively. Now, you know that Gary is a huge advocate of digital marketing and that he uses digital marketing as a very effective part of his marketing plan at LifeSmiles Dental Care. So today we have a special guest on the Thriving Dentist Show who's an expert in digital and online marketing. He has been involved with the dental profession for over 25 years, and he's a master at teaching dentists how to attract patients through internet domination. And he also knows how to coordinate the many elements of an online marketing plan to work effectively so they attract precisely the type of patients that you want to have. We don't want everybody. We have a certain type of patient we want. So this show will be so filled with content that you're going to probably want to listen to it a couple times. And so let's get started. And Gary, I want to welcome you as always to the show.
Hey, Andy, it's great to be here. I'm really excited about this show. Mark is a good friend, hailing from the UK, hailing from England, and you'll recognize that in his wonderful accent. But hey, Mark, let me welcome you to the show. It's great to have you on the show.
Thank you very much. It's an absolute pleasure to be here.
Well, and I'm going to go ahead and throw it to you, Gary, and Mark, I don't want to butcher your last name, Oborn.
Oborn, yes.
Oborn, and that's O-B-O-R-N for those who want to search for him, but we'll also have some links at the end of the show on ways to reach out to Mark if you need to have some further conversation with him. But I'm going to step back and throw it to you, Gary.
Well, hey, Mark, this is going to be a lot of fun, and we've chosen the topic of the show to be internet domination. And I love that title, by the way, because you are the master of internet domination, and I can't wait to get into that topic. But before we do, I want to introduce a little sidebar to our listeners. Besides your background, and by the way, you have a wonderful background, over 25 years in the dental profession, and you've really seen it from a number of different vantage points. And I really love and respect your background, Mark. But a little piece of your background that would be of interest to our listeners is that in addition to your experience in dentistry and your experience in marketing in dentistry, which we'll talk about later in the show, you are also a mastered certified practitioner of NLP, of Neuro-Linguistic Programming Communication.
I am.
For our listeners who are not familiar with NLP, can you give us a short little summary of what NLP is all about and why listeners might want to learn a little bit more about this really cool science?
Sure. I think the first thing to understand with NLP is that it doesn't exist. There is not one single train of thought or one single philosophy or one single understanding of what NLP is. NLP is a collection of ideas and philosophies and thoughts from around the world. And I use it really in three specific areas, but they all relate to communication. So some people would say talking to new patients, people might call that sales. I just call that elegant communication with new patients. Some people talk about team motivation. Again, I call that elegant communication with the team. And the third thing is practices talk about motivating patients to follow their oral healthcare advice and having problems with that sometimes. And again, I just call that elegant communication with your patients. And NLP allows me to help my clients elegantly communicate with their patients, with their team, with their prospective patients to get the job done. It's a communication model.
Mark, that was an excellent summary. You just really summarized what effective NLP communication is all about. We talked about this. I happened to be visiting England recently to speak at the dentistry show, and you and I happened to visit about that face-to-face. And I love the science of NLP. And Mark, if you would be kind enough, may I extend an invitation to you? Would you be willing to come back on the Thriving Dentist Show and have you and I do a specific discussion around NLP communication, and especially around the concept of elegant communication in the three different realms that you've introduced? Would you be willing to come on back and do that?
I would love to. Absolutely love to.
All right, consider that a deal. We'll figuratively handshake over these 5,700 miles that we're apart today, but we'll get you back. Well, let's get to the topic at hand. Many of our listeners will already know you, Mark, but for those that don't, quick introduction. You've been in the dental profession for over 25 years, and you've developed a field of expertise within the area of internet marketing and digital marketing, and that's what we're going to talk about today. And I want to invite our listeners to visit your website. Your intro video, which I think is about 4 minutes long, is a fabulous video that summarizes how you integrate the different elements of a marketing plan and why an integrated digital marketing plan is so effective. Mark, would you be kind enough to provide your URL, your website address for our listeners, and we'll make sure we put that on our in our show notes. But would you provide our listeners with your website address?
Sure. It's very easy. It's my name, which is Mark Oborn, MarkOborn.com.
And spend some time, listeners, watching that short video. It's absolutely fabulous, and you will understand how important it is to integrate all of this. Well, Mark, if you don't mind, I'm going to dive right in. So let's start with being critical for just a minute, because like you, I think that there's a lot of things wrong with the way that many dental practices market themselves. From your vantage point, what is wrong with most dental marketing?
Well, that's a big question, isn't it? What's wrong? Let's look at it from this way. When I first started to look at dental practice marketing, I was coming at it from other industries, looking at what do other industries do, what do other sectors in other industries do. And it struck me that we've got two types of marketing, two types of industry. We've got product marketing, product industries, and we've got service industries. What I'd like to do at this part really is to talk about the difference between the two, because I think that is absolutely fundamental to understanding why I believe dental marketing is wrong in most practices. So the first thing is, let's say we look at a product. So I'm sitting here talking to you using a Skype headset. So let's say I want to buy a new Skype headset. I just go to the Skype headset store, and I can check out all the headsets that they've got on the racks there, and I can try them out beforehand. I can test them out. I can ask the salesman, you know, does this fulfill my requirements? We can have a discussion about it. And then I can take my Skype headset home, and if it works out fine, that's perfect. I'm happy with the purchase. But if it doesn't live up to the expectation, or more importantly, doesn't live up to how it was sold to me, I can take it back. So the risk with purchasing a product like that is quite low. But let's look at dentistry. Well, let's look at a service. What is a service? So a service is exactly what we're doing now. So a service is, as I am producing this service to you and to your listeners, they are consuming it. That happens synchronously. It happens at exactly the same time. As a service is produced, it is consumed. And as your listeners listen to different Thriving Dentist shows and you have different guests, you're providing perhaps a similar service, but it varies according to who is delivering it. Mm-hmm. And the absolute key to a service is that if the words that I deliver to your listeners they don't like, they can't give them back. They can't unlisten. They can't unlearn. That is absolutely vital to understand, because service marketing is about increasing trust and reducing risk, because risk is high. Because you can't evaluate the stuff beforehand, because it's delivered and consumed at the same time, and the service provider is going to be different in the quality of what they deliver. So risk is very high for delivery of a service. So the question I would ask your listeners is, what is dentistry? Is it a product or a service?
Yes.
And if the answer to that question is it is a service, then we need to be looking at service-based marketing and not product-based marketing. Let's put it like this. If I go out and purchase a new car for $20,000, I can purchase that car for $20,000. I can test it out beforehand. And if I don't like it, I can take it back. Or if it doesn't fulfill the requirements, I can take it back. So the risk of spending $20,000 on a car is actually quite low. If I go to a dentist and I have an amalgam filling removed and I have it replaced with a nice white filling, it may cost me $200. But the risk to me as a patient going to that dentist is high, because the service will depend upon who is delivering the service and I can't take it back. So the reason so much marketing in dentistry is wrong is because the dentists are marketing it as a product. And a product is about getting a person to make a snap decision because risk is low. Dental marketing risk is high. So my purchasing of a white filling for $200 is infinitely more risk than purchasing a car for $20,000. So it's not about the money. It's about what is delivered. And dental marketing should be about reducing risk and increasing trust, not about getting a quick sale, which is what people try to do in product marketing.
Mark, you've raised such a great point in the distinction between marketing a product versus marketing a service. Thank you for that framework, because it is so fundamentally different. And I think you're right. I think that many dental practices market their services as a product, you know, as opposed to a service. And I love your distinction about the importance of establishing trust. And so much of what you do is you teach your clients how to establish trust in your marketing so that consumers can make great decisions and find a great match. And I love the way that you focus on that trust component, because it is just so, so very important. Let's switch gears and get kind of specific here, Mark. You're an advocate of email marketing, and, mm-hmm. and you do it extremely well. You teach it extremely well. Email marketing is something that is not on the radar screen for most dentists, and it should be. Can you explain how dentists can use email marketing as part of their digital marketing activities?
Sure. So email marketing, in fact, online marketing is the perfect way to increase trust and reduce risk. Because one of the things that a patient is always going to be looking for is, can you produce that quality of service over and over and over again? Using email and online marketing, social media as well, we can demonstrate over and over and over again that we're a trustworthy business. And that is how I use email, to answer people's specific questions and to hand out useful, free, relevant advice. Patients, they don't want to be sold to. They don't want someone to start offering them buy one, get one free. They want to know that you as a dentist are absolutely trustworthy, that the risk is as low as it can be, and that you can deliver the quality of service over and over. So I use email literally to hand out useful, free, relevant advice. And I use the whole of online marketing to do that, Facebook and Twitter as well. And once we understand that as a concept, that online dental marketing is about increasing trust and reducing risk, it forms the backbone of social media, of Facebook, of Twitter, and of email. And they're just different mediums for handing out useful, free, relevant advice. So the way I do it with email is I never purchase an email database. If you purchase an email database, it's spam. You have to start sending people emails, and it's like cold calling. And instantly, trust and risk are affected. So I build email databases organically through my client websites. And the way we do that is by handing out a resource pack. So we typically would have a straighter teeth resource pack, a missing teeth one, an oral healthcare, facial aesthetics if the practices do that. And we put together guides, and we hand out free guides, resource information about those problem areas that patients are looking for, they can land on the website. There's loads of great content there for them to read and to find out more about solving their problem. And then there's a free resource pack, which they download. And that download is always in exchange for an email address. Once we've got their email address, they then drop into an automated email marketing program, a gentle email marketing that helps them with their problem and is not there to try and sell them stuff. It's just there to educate and to help them. And the program that I use to do that is Aweber, which is aweber.com. It's $19 a month, so it's a no-brainer. And that manages all of my email marketing like a dream.
This is fabulous, Mark. I really like the strategy that you've developed. So if I understand it properly, a consumer, a potential patient, will land on the site. They'll see something on the website that provides information in the form of a health and help and information pack of information. Yeah. They then can receive that virtually instantly, digitally, in exchange for providing an email address. And through that, you build an email list organically. Did I understand the framework of that correctly?
You did. It's perfect.
So, Mark, help our listeners understand how much information might be provided in that information pack. How much detail? How much? Let's take a short-term adult orthodontics. As a topic here, I heard you indicate that might be a sample. Let's say in my own practice, we happen to do 6 month smiles. Dr. Nielsen is trained in that, and we provide that. And we provide short-term adult orthodontic treatment. What type of information might we provide in that that help and information pack related to that?
Okay. Whenever you structure marketing or structure communication, and this goes back to the NLP. There's a system in NLP called the format system. And the format system uses four key areas of why, what, how, and what if. So the websites should be structured the same way. And we structure the free guides in exactly the same way. So the first question is why. Why should this person listen to your advice about having straighter teeth? So it's why should you have straighter teeth? Possibly there could be the aesthetic concerns, but there's also their oral health concerns. So straighter teeth are easier to clean. They're easier to floss between. We get less biofilm, which means less plaque, which means healthier teeth, which means you keep them for longer. So the first part of the guide is why. Why should this person read any further? The next step is what. So what are the systems you offer? 6 month smiles, Inman aligner, CFAST, Invisalign, any of the others. So we do a what. And then that is specifically, what is this system? What is the difference between the various short-term orthodontic systems? What is the difference between those and perhaps some of the longer-term orthodontic systems? So that's the why, the what. We then look at how. So how do each of these systems work? 6 month smiles works over 6 months. And how practically would that patient have that service delivered to them? What type of system is it? How does it work? How is the patient going to feel when they're wearing it? And the last one is what if. So the what if is allowing the patient to try on, if you will, their new smile. So what if you went for these treatments? What difference would it make in your life? What would you be able to do that you can't do now? And I use that format system, why, what, how, what if, to write a web page, to write a free email guide, and to write the follow-up emails that go within the system. And it's those four questions should be answered all of the time because they're really, really important. And it guides people right the way through simply and easily reading any content that you want to put out there.
You know, this is, again, Mark, this is absolutely brilliant because the way most websites are structured for dentists is that we attract eyeballs or we attract viewers to the site, and then we expect them to make an instantaneous decision about whether they're going to call us and make an appointment or not. And yet for the more sophisticated treatment areas in dentistry, the more comprehensive the more expensive, the more elective services, oftentimes they need information to make that decision. And by providing that information to them, you're really serving a vital need. And of course, in turn, in a very subtle way, you are positioning yourself as the authority and the expert in that area. And Mark, it's absolutely brilliant. And I can't wait to apply an email marketing campaign to my own practice. Because if listeners are using email, I suspect that they're using email to their existing patients to communicate in some way or another to their existing patients, which is, you know, a perfectly adequate way to use email communication. However, you've introduced an entirely different way to use email, to build a list of people that are interested in what it is that we're providing. And in turn, having a very convenient automated way to follow up with those people to move them from a potential patient to an active patient in the practice. And it's absolutely brilliant. And I hope our listeners are excited as this as I am. What a great addition to the marketing plan that you may already have in place.
Sure. I think the key difference to realize is that email marketing it's not about a massive splurge of marketing and then wait for a response like it is if we were to do direct marketing or some form of advert in the radio or something like that. It's about building trust and reducing risk over a period of time. And it's kind of backwards marketing. It's this altruistic marketing. So rather than asking for anything from people, we just give, and we hand out. And then there's a concept called the norms of reciprocity, which means that if we hand out over and over and over again, the person that we're handing out that fantastic information to feels an absolute burning need to reciprocate. So the concept of online marketing is that we give, and then at certain times throughout the year, then we look to appropriate the asset of that list. It's not constant. So we're not constantly saying, come to us, we're the best. We just hand out. And then perhaps once every 3 or 4 months, we may offer some form of incentive to that specific list in order to generate the revenues that we obviously need as a business and to bring the patients in. And we're going to an educated list that know that we are trustworthy, that know that risk is lower, that know why they should come for treatment, what the treatment is, how the treatment is delivered, what if they were to have the treatment. It's a red hot list. And more than that, it's a red hot list of specific people. So if you're going to have an open evening, for argument's sake, and you want to bring in the local people to talk about short-term orthodontics, you've got a ready-made list of people to go to. You don't have to go to you know, third-party websites to buy lists. You've got your own list.
We know who they are. They've already elected to have interest in this. That's
absolutely
fantastic. And Mark, you've indicated that this is an approach you use across different marketing platforms. In other words, this is not just an approach that works in email marketing. But I wanted you to cover that email marketing segment because it's so unique. I simply haven't seen it done with the sophistication and strategy that you have done to put this together, which is, I really want to compliment you on that. You have put together an amazing program, and it combines the psychology of consumers, which I imagine your NLP training really gives you a good perspective on how to think like a consumer.
Absolutely.
And you've really put it together in a cool way that is very unique in dentistry. So I want to talk about email marketing, but this is not a concept that's limited to email. It applies to anything online. Is that correct?
The philosophy applies to everything that you do. So if we do Facebook and Twitter, it's exactly the same. If you want to do YouTube, it's the same. Pinterest, which is photograph, Instagram, the principle is the same. All we do is we hand out useful, free, relevant advice. Facebook becomes your list. Twitter becomes a list. Instagram becomes a list. Pinterest becomes a list. We hand out information. We help those people. And then periodically, we can make an attempt to appropriate that list. We can also use, if you do email marketing off of your website, as we've been saying, around the various treatment and services that you offer, you can then use sort of the wider internet, so Facebook, Twitter, Pinterest, YouTube, Instagram, all these other sites, to build relationships with people by handing out advice and then drive them to your website. So you can then say on Facebook, hey guys, you know, over the past couple of months, we've been talking about, you know, all the reasons that you'd want to have straight teeth and how you can have healthier teeth. Why don't you visit my website where I've got a free guide and you can download it? And then they're using Facebook and Twitter in a much more coordinated way to drive traffic to the website, where you've got the website where you're collecting the email addresses. And to even take it wider than that, I use it not only online, I use it offline as well. So all of my business cards, on the back of the business cards, all of them say, visit my website today and download your free guide to dental implants, replacing missing teeth, straightening crooked teeth, having a more cosmetic smile. So we're using it all of the time. I get quite excited about this, as you can probably tell. You can use it if you do direct mail. So direct mail, you can have a direct call to action, call us today on your direct mail marketing. But what about those people that don't want to call you today, but they might want some more information? Put onto that. And why don't you visit our website where you can download our free guide to everything you need to know about replacing missing teeth? And it becomes a philosophy that is used across online marketing and offline marketing and everything that you do.
I'm just sitting here. This is one time, Andy, where I wish this was a video format instead of just an audio format. Because Mark, I am sitting here smiling ear to ear, and pardon my enthusiasm about this, but I am just so excited about how you've put this together. It's just remarkable. I'm thinking about it, and I'm thinking about how consistent it is with my philosophy of how I use social media myself. Mark, you and I are friends personally, besides virtually. You know, we're friends on Facebook, and
we're
real friends. I mean, we're actually, you know, physically real friends. You know, in between the times we see each other, which because of the distance, you know, we're about 5,700 miles apart. We don't get to see each other too frequently, but we stay connected to one another through our social media contacts. And so you follow me on Twitter. I follow you on Twitter. And Mark, you notice on Twitter that one of the things that I do is that I am very generous about providing information to my followers and my friends on Twitter. And I've never really thought about it with the degree of sophistication that you put this together. It is absolutely my philosophy of how you use the social media channels to build relationship and build rapport. And I want to back up. You introduced a term that I've never heard before, but instantly it made sense to me. And it was the term called norms of reciprocity. Tell us more about that. That makes sense. I mean, in a way, it's something that is common sense, but sometimes common sense isn't so common. Talk about norms of reciprocity.
All the norm, you know, I mention this in presentations quite often, and it's the term that gets picked up. For some reason, people seem to love it as a term. It was something that I came by when I did my MBA, and we were looking at the difference between relationship marketing and transactional marketing. So transactional marketing we use in products, which is buy it now, buy one, get one free, you know, do it today, limited offer, time runs out. That's transactional marketing. Whereas when we're looking at relationship marketing and we're looking for a relationship with a person over a period of time, that's when the norms of reciprocity come in. And it's very simple. All it means is that if we give without asking for anything back, the person that we're giving to becomes that they feel that they need to reciprocate at some point. They feel
that's a human response, isn't it?
Correct. It is. It's a human response. And we're not trying to manipulate it. We're just working with a natural human response. And we like to do business with people that we like. So let's just help people like us. Let's just give stuff away. And you know what, Gary? for the two of us, if we give our secrets away, it's possible that our clients could pick it up and do it themselves. So I write a blog, and on my blog, I write how to go and do it and how to go and do it yourself. So there's actually a risk for you and I. But for dentists, there's not really much of a risk that a patient can go away and straighten their teeth by themselves. So a dentist can hand out massive amount of information, because ultimately their client, the consumer, can't go and sort the problem out themselves. They have to go to a dentist. So if we just educate people and hand out information, as you say, the natural tendency as a human being is to want to reciprocate. And we do business with people that we like. So let's just help people like us.
See, that just makes so much sense. And, you know, even in our worlds, you know, your world as a coach and advisor, and my world as a coach, it works well in our world too. I mean, this show is founded on that principle. The Thriving Dentist Show is available free of charge on iTunes. And we give away information. And I absolutely love the platform that this show provides. And it's an example of precisely what you're talking about. Mark, I'm still intrigued by this whole science and this whole concept of norms of reciprocity, and I'm going to get specific with you here. And is there a formula, you know, and I don't mean a specific one, but is there a loose formula of you give away X number of times before you ask for something? Is there a formula, or can you help our listeners better understand what that relationship is between, you know, the provision of information and the ask? What have you found in that?
There isn't a specific formula, no. The way I advise my clients to structure their online marketing is around three specific areas. So this is Facebook and Twitter specifically. Is to look at, the first thing is to have some bonds, actor bonds we call them. So bonds between the actors in a relationship. So we've said we do business with people that we like, and we like people that we are like. So if we help people to like us, it goes a long way to helping that relationship develop. So I would say 40% of all of your messages should be about just you as an individual, as a unique, exquisite individual, and help your potential customers to like you. Okay. The second thing is to give them something to do to help them, to point them to resources. Now, you and I both do this. We direct our potential clients to websites and resources other than our own.
Because I use a specific example that's very pertinent today? And this will be very relevant to our listeners. Mark, here we are. I'm in the United States. Here in the month of April has been declared the Oral Cancer Awareness Month in the month of April. So April is Oral Cancer Awareness Month. And you probably noticed a couple of my tweets today where I directed my followers to the Oral Cancer Foundation, which is a nonprofit organization to help increase awareness of oral cancer. I'm not related to it. It's not me. It's simply providing my viewers information that I think will be of interest to them. Would that be an example of helping our friends have valid information?
Perfect. Yeah, perfect example. And dentists can point people off to the oral cancer foundations to help people with oral cancer, resources for halitosis, resources for what happens if your gums are bleeding. There are loads of resources all the way around the internet. Medworm.com is a great place. It's an aggregator of medical health resources. And you can go in, you can type halitosis, and it will pull up a load of blog posts and articles about halitosis, as an example. So I would say 40% of the messages on Facebook and Twitter should be those kind of links. And the act of clicking on a link helps a person to engage with you a little bit further. And then 20% of the messages, the final 20% should be the appropriation. So the final 20% is come and see me, spend some time, spend some money with me specifically. So it's 40% of your time building relationships, 40% of your time handing out information, and 20% of your time saying, come to me.
That's brilliant. You just gave us the formula.
But there's no empirical base to that. It was just, I've been asked the question a few times before, and I've had to think, well, okay, well, what would my answer be? And that's what I tell people if I do a presentation, if I run courses, that's the formula that I give. And it seems to work well. I think what it just stops people wanting to talk about themselves the whole time, we tend to be quite good at. And if we just put a number on and say no more than 20%, then we should be fine.
Oh, I like that. And thank you. And I knew I put you on the spot to provide a formula. And I like the way you did it anecdotally rather than just pulling out raw numbers. So thank you, Mark. Hey, I want to conclude. I've got one more really important question. And perhaps I should have started here in the interview, but I thought it fit better here at the end. And so the question I have for you, Mark, is this. It's an important one. How can dentists develop the right mindset regarding practice marketing? And what is the biggest barrier to success, often in the mind of the dentist, between those ears? So how can they develop the right mindset? And what is the biggest barrier to success in the mind of dentists when it comes to marketing?
Specifically talking about marketing, I think the biggest barrier is seeing of other dentists seeing a lot of the marketing that is talked about, which is the transactional marketing, which is buy one get one free, special offers, discounts, and incentives with time limited offers. I think the biggest barrier is in their mindset is to realize that marketing is that's not marketing. Well, it is marketing, but it's marketing for a product. Marketing for dentistry is about extending your oral health care advice and your unique, exquisite care for that single individual and putting that online. And when we do that, it's more authentic, it's real. Patients get it. Patients understand it. They know that the dentist is not in it just trying to make a fast buck. They're there because they genuinely care. And I think the biggest shift that dentists can make in their mindset is to view marketing that way, as an extension of the oral health care advice that they give patients in the practice, rather than marketing is something that's a bit crude and a bit crass that we kind of have to do. One other thing that I want to challenge here is the notion that dentistry is retail. There's lots of talk, certainly in the UK, about dentistry being retail. And dentistry absolutely competes with the retail dollar or the retail pound. The person only has a certain amount of money to spend. But I think the danger when we view marketing that way for dentistry is that we start to turn it into sofa sale dentistry, which is about getting people to make a snap decision. And I think the biggest mindset shift, as we've said, that dentists can make is just to hand out information. And it doesn't always come naturally, because we want to keep saying, come and spend money with me, come and spend money with me. But if we flip it backwards, that's when you get a paradigm shift in the way you think and the way the practice marketing works.
Mark, may I introduce a related concept to this conversation?
Sure.
This is something I've been thinking a lot about. I love the way you have explained the difference between relationship marketing and transactional marketing. It absolutely parallels my path as a practice owner. When Dr. Nielsen and I bought our practice almost 6 years ago now, it was very much a transactional practice. Everything that was done was based around transactions. And we began from day one to change that into a relationship practice. And today, it's very much a relationship-driven practice as opposed to a transactional practice. Mm. And I can see the need to evolve our marketing in the same way, to evolve our marketing to reflect that relationship marketing as opposed to transactional marketing. But the concept I wanted to introduce was the concept of dentistry as a commodity. To some, can we agree, Mark, that to some people, dentistry is a commodity? In other words, a crown is a crown is a crown is a crown. And they view it as a commodity. However, I think that person is in the minority, you know, in terms of the universe of patients at large. But to some people, it's simply a transaction that they're seeking to procure at the lowest possible price. Would you agree there are people like that?
I would agree. Can I say something that may be a bit controversial?
Please.
I think dentists are to blame for that, because dentistry has been marketing itself as a product. And if we continue to market ourselves as a product, we will continue to commoditize even more areas of dentistry.
Absolutely. And thank you for raising that, albeit controversial statement, but I want to jump right in and tell you I'm in complete agreement. Complete agreement. So if we get hate mail, we'll get it together. Is that all right?
That's fine. We'll share.
But anyway, we'll share it. We'll share the love or share the hate. Mark, I do believe that for most people, dentistry is not a commodity. It's not a commodity in the way that, let's use an example. Let's say, Mark, you or I are in the market for a flat screen television set.
Yeah.
Okay. And we do some research and we look at features and we're studying things like pixels per square inch, and we're studying the different electronic configuration. I believe that for many people, purchasing that television set will be very much a commodity purchase that will be driven by features and price.
Absolutely.
However, when it comes to dentistry, I don't believe that many people want to make their decisions purely on the way they'd make decisions relative to the purchase of the product. It has so much to do with the trust and confidence they have in the provider. So I really believe that the consumer is desiring a relationship decision as opposed to a commodity decision. Would you agree with that?
Absolutely. Yes.
And I think if we lead with the proper marketing, we're going to be attracting the kind of patients. Maybe it's not all of them, but we'll be attracting the kind of patients that think like that and will arrive to our practice well-informed, well-educated, with a high degree of trust and confidence. And pardon my enthusiasm about this, but all that's cool stuff.
Absolutely. And why wouldn't we want to do that? Why would we want to be attracting anybody into the practice just because they can get a cheap crown for, you know, half price on a one day of the week, or, you know, for the next 2 weeks? Those, you know, why wouldn't we want to be encouraging the right type of patient into the practice that wants to stay with us, where we can do what we've trained to do, which is to look after their healthcare? That's what we're in it for.
Absolutely. You know, Mark, in the 40 minutes that we've been talking about this, I just took a look at our timer. In the 40 minutes that we've been talking about this, you have provided so much value to our listeners. But what I want to do is I want to invite our listeners to connect with you more intimately and in more detail. Mark, you are an amazing resource. You're a great friend. You're an amazing resource. And I want to invite our listeners to learn more. It seems like we just barely nicked the surface. There's so much more to learn. Mark, how is the best way for our listeners to connect with you?
Well, one of the things I've said that I do is Internet Domination. Go to Google, type my name. Just type Mark Oborn.
It might be proof of concept there, wouldn't it?
The first 10 pages of Google is all me. So you'll find my blog, you'll find Twitter, Facebook, YouTube channels, and it's all there. Everything that I've been talking about, how to do it, how to set it up, how to use Aweber, how to use social media, the split, the 40%, 40%, 20% is all there. Just go and look it up.
You know, Andy, I don't know how you've been able to be quiet through this entire show, because I know that Mark is striking a very resonant nerve for you. This is stuff that you're deeply interested in. You know,
yeah,
the three of us, Mark,
my accent's not as good,
Andy and myself, we're nerds. Mark, I hope you don't mind that I called you a nerd.
No, I'm good with that.
That's a badge of, you know, that's a badge of honor. I wear my nerdiness with honor. And the three of us are kindred spirits in being nerds. And I mean that in the ultimate form of compliment, Mark. But Andy, I don't know how you've been quiet through this entire interview.
Well, I find a way.
Do you see why I wanted to have Mark on the show?
Absolutely. And Mark, again, that's markoborn.com. That's the best place for folks to find you.
Absolutely, yes.
Awesome, awesome. Well, thank you for joining us today. And Gary, thank you for your time as well.
No problem.
Oh, this has been fantastic. And Mark, we are going to have you back on a future show where we're going to talk about NLP. So stay tuned for that, our listeners. On that note, Mark, let me thank you myself. Thanks so much for being here today.
No problem. The pleasure really has all been mine. Because better days are sure to come. And when you smile, be sure to smile wide. And don't let them know that they have won. And when you walk, walk with pride. Don't show the hurt inside, because the pain will soon be gone.